Go.
All right. Welcome here once again this morning, Peace Baptist. Those of you on Facebook, glad to have you with us. I want to make a few announcements before we get started with today's service. Tomorrow is our Marvelous Mondays with James Fisher, but it looks like as of now with the storm out there, we're going to have to cancel tomorrow night. The storm actually probably may not get here till after our Marvelous Mondays would be over, but if it speeds up, we could get here earlier. Plus, James Fisher's from Greensboro, so he would be spending the night here, and then we don't know what he would face going trying to get back home Tuesday morning, so we don't want to put him in that danger either. And you know, as of right now, still kind of unsteady. If it makes a little westward turn, it could come right over where we're at. So just a lot of uncertainty there right now. So needing to cancel reservations and such that we've made, we just feel like it's probably the better thing to do right now. Plus, we don't know how many people would actually be here with the storm approaching. So, as of right now, we're going to attempt to cancel Marvelous Mondays for tomorrow night. But we will have Mr. Fisher back. Remember, next Sunday and Monday night, Dr. Ernie Perkins will be here for both Sunday services and for the Monday night service. So be here to support him in that. On the 12th, we'll have our business meeting, which is our annual business meeting to elect officers and to approve the budget for the upcoming church year, which begins the first Sunday of September. So you'll have those contacting you about your current positions. If you want to maintain those current positions, if God's leading you to a different position, then please let them know that. And please don't feel like, well, that's so-and-so's class. I'm not going to take it. You know, it may be that so-and-so is in that position because no one would take it. But God's leading you to it, and that may be where you need to be. And so, then speak up and let us know. Children's ministry. June, on behalf of the children's ministry, is taking monetary donations to cover the cost of supplying children with individual pencil bags for when they start back to school in a few weeks. With all this coronavirus stuff going on, everyone's got to have their own individual bags. Most time they have in the past anyway, but even more so now. They'll need their own due to not sharing. And the fact that part of the students will be on Monday, Tuesday, part of them will be on Thursday, Friday, so they won't be able to share a whole lot anyway, so they need their own individual bags. But she's wanting to take up money to assist those kids who are purchasing those things. I think there's going to be pencils and eraser, a pencil sharpener, just the plastic holder itself. So if you want to help her with that, I'm sure she'd truly appreciate it. Our recovery night seems to be on Thursday night, but that is just divorce care and grief share. Separate recovery is taking a hiatus during the summer. We'll start back on September the 10th. Nick Moorhead is still doing a study in the book of Revelation. It's on 7 o'clock on Tuesday night, so we're in the fellowship off. We're going to be part of that. Don't forget about our church app. If you haven't downloaded that and you want to, 77977, just put in Peace BC APP. I tell you, you can tithe online faster than you can write a check. Get two or three buttons and there it is. And if you have anything that we need to know about, that the church needs to know about, please call the office and let us know so we can get out. We are looking at a new system, you know, our phone tree system we had, and it's kind of, it's an analog format. Everything's pretty much gone digital now, so our phone tree is not working, but we are looking at a new system called OneCall that we're going to try to see about getting funded and starting that before long. But until then, anything you need us to know, please let us know so we can push that out to everyone in whatever methods we have. All right, is there anything else we need to know about? All right, well, we're glad to have you here today. We're going to look a little bit different this morning due to sicknesses and things such as that. Dawn's out of town with her dad. He's having some surgeries. Kelsey, bless her heart, she just got out of the hospital yesterday. She had a procedure done. She He's a trooper. Little bit's got a migraine. So this is what you got. Very good. But we're here, Christ is here, and we're going to worship him anyway, right? So y'all stand there, let's sing. You can just look across there and say, hey, glad to have you here today. And vice versa.
Child.
you are.
Amen.
It's going to take them just a second, but this is a song that gets requested every now and then, and like David pointed out, it only has the title in it one time, but it's a beautiful song.
Make him feel like this is where he belongs ever since.
That's right.
So we're glad to have you, brother.
Yeah. We're going to be in the book of Jude, if you want to flip there. We're going to move around a little bit through some scripture, but You don't have to flip back and forth. You can jot down some scriptures as we get there, but the actual passage I'm going to chuck on is the book of Jude, and we're going to read some stuff in the beginning and then finish in the end of the book. And I'm asking you to bear with me with this. God worked on me through this scripture, and I was actually going somewhere else when Stephen asked me. I've been restudying through the Old Testament, reading through 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, and now I've been working through 1 Kings. And so I was going to kind of emphasize in there and work through that scripture, but God changed it yesterday and moved me to this passage. And it's been a rough day yesterday. A lot of people don't know that. I really spoke to Heather about this or nothing, but he did some work on me through the scripture, and maybe he can work on you in it too, so, but I'm going to try to keep it together. First thing we'll do is book of Jude, verse 3, we're going to start there. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once and for all delivered to the saints. Verse 4, for certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men, who turn the grace of our God into lewdness and deny the Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Jude was writing to the people, and he said, man, listen to me. He said, it's necessary for me to write this to you. I'm writing to you concerning that, man, you stay strong in the faith that was given to you. You stay strong in that, but I can't just elaborate on the grace that was given to you and the faith that we both have in Christ Jesus. He said, it is so necessary that I write to you, all right, listen to me, verse 4, that certain men, all right, have crept in unnoticed into the church, but into your society and around you that have been marked and have called lewdness in you, or immoral living. I don't know if you've noticed before, if you've lived long enough and been in multiple churches, you've seen people that have been pressed in, that have sat in, and spent time in, and been with you, and gone on mission trips, and have always been the vision. They've always kind of pushed in to break down the barriers of holiness in the church and brainwash you and milk it down with what? Lewdness or immoral living. You see it through the churches today, and just in the one thing of homosexuality, if you would really study it, you will see how many churches right now, because of the push of Satan, and people that press it, and they press it, and they press it, they start breaking down. And instead of living to the high standards of holiness that God pressed upon us, we slowly accept it. And we slowly say, well, maybe that's right. And maybe we should allow it. And maybe we should still, we should love them but hate the sin. But we never address the sin, and we allow it to become the church. And Jude was thinking, and he said, yes, I want to speak to you about the holiness and the faith that we both have in Christ Jesus, but I cannot not mention to tell you and to warn you that people are in the church and are amongst you that have been pressed in, that have been there, and they've crept in unnoticed, and you haven't noticed it, but they're here, and they're pushing lewdness in the church, immoral living, and don't miss this, and the last part of verse 4, and they deny the only Lord God, our Lord Jesus Christ. You can look up television preachers and preachers in churches pull up sermons where they have came out and be like, and they will brainwash the idea that Jesus ain't, he can't be the only one. We need to live right. We need to do things. And they will not hearken that Jesus is the only way. It happens. And they stand in the pulpit and teach it. It happens. They've crept in. And they're smooth talkers, which we'll get to more a little later. But my thing is, how does this happen? How does the church and the people of God get to a place that we allow someone to sneak in and creep among us and live among us and we just don't know it? Or how does a person be so involved with the church and so in love with God, and the next thing they know, they're caught in immoral living and they've walked away from the church? And this is, we're going to venture back into the Old Testament, because I don't know if you don't read the Old Testament, but I personally love the Old Testament. To me, you can't fully understand the New Testament unless you know the Old Testament. You'll never understand the holiness of God that required a desperate death from Jesus Christ without knowing that holiness that God required of his people. You'll never understand it. You'll never understand Revelations unless you understand the books of the Old Testament that speak on what's going to come. If you read through the New Testament, every writer of the New Testament quoted the Old Testament. So as a church today to say, well, we're under grace and mercy in the New Testament, you are naive to think that it didn't come from the Old Testament. But I love the Old Testament, so I venture back a lot. Like I said, that's what I've been reading. But how is it that this happens? You understand that Satan is the king of deception. He's clever. If you think you can fight the wiles of the devil by yourself, you are misinterpreted. You've misinterpreted scripture, you're misled, and you will falter at what he will do. You will falter at what God has in store for you, because you cannot fight Satan by yourself. Listen to me. But the only way, the only way for the church to be victorious is to seek holiness while clinging to grace and following Jesus. Don't miss that. The only way to be victorious against Satan and his plans is to seek holiness, which we cannot reach without Jesus. Seek holiness, but God has always called us to be holy. Seek holiness while clinging to grace and following Jesus. Now the church, I don't know if you've seen it or not, but if you look around in your society, we're just going to take the Western church, because this ain't the way the church looks in the Eastern culture. So we're not going to even speak on that, because Christians in Eastern culture, they get killed to come to church. They love the church. They love God. They love Jesus. They love the Bible. They will lay their life down for it, for one page of scripture. So this ain't the church as a whole. This is Western culture, where we have no, don't get me wrong, we have the greatest power in the world. We have the greatest power source to tap into, but we do not do it. God said, I will bring down and give you. I'm going to give you the greatest comforter, the greatest power source. You just got to go with it and let him come with you. So if the church will not have no power in this world until this sacred assembly, the church meeting, until the church becomes a sacred assembly again. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying we're no cult and we don't teach the world and we don't go into the world and we just hoard ourselves and close the doors and we become a sacred cult. No, I'm saying until we become a sacred assembly before God, all right? And this sacred assembly, when it becomes holy in the sight of God, then you'll see the power. You'll see God moving away across our culture and through our communities that we've never seen before. We've never tasted it. We've never seen it. most people have not even on the smallest minute even witnessed it. You see things in the Bible and say, well, that was a biblical days. No, it's not. The things that happened in the Bible are not reserved for 2,000 years ago. The same God that wrote the Bible is the same God that lives today. He's the same God that's going to live tomorrow. And he's the same God who's going to come down and rapture his children. He's the same God that's going to split the heavens. And he's going to take on Satan. He's going to be defeatless. He's the same God that's going to bring down a new heaven and earth. He is the same God. It's the same people. Peter, Paul, they were not special. Fishermen. One of them killed hundreds, if not thousands, of Christians. King David, an adulteress who had a man murdered in the battlefield. Now listen to me now, these are not special people. They just came to a place in their life where they seek holiness, where they seek to follow Jesus no matter what. Paul said, I will go anywhere you lead me, through chains, through bruises, through death, and he went across the world. Two bondage, two chains, and in chains he still penned and wrote what God wanted them to. They're not special people. We're not special people. But God wants to work. He wants his glory to be found. He wants people to see him. Now, so I'm going to take you back to the Old Testament tonight. Listen to me. We're going to go back to King Solomon. I just mentioned King David, who, even though we talked about some of the things he did wrong, you understand that the Bible says that King David was a man after God's own heart.
Right.
All right? The man I said committed adultery had another man dead. All right? But do you understand that for what King David did, there was a punishment? Everybody said, oh, we got grace, we got mercy, it don't matter. No, it does matter. King David had a man, he slept with a woman, got her pregnant, and because she got pregnant, he had her husband killed. Okay? God used a prophet to come to speak to King David. King David hears and says, that man should surely die. That man should surely die. The prophet looks at King David and says, that man was you. King David says, I sinned against God. It don't say a lot more, but I'm pretty sure he was broken in his spirit. Because what's the scripture say? The prophet then looks at him and says, God forgives you. And he will build a line of descendants through you. He will give you the kingdom and you will reign over it. And I will make your line of descendants the kingdom. That's the King David. But then he has a son. Now listen, that kid, that wife that he cheated with, she has a baby. Here's the thing. God forgave him, but there was a consequence. What happened to that little kid? He died. Do you understand the magnitude of God's holiness? I don't think we read it in these terms. We ought to look at the good things. But God said, I forgive you, but that child will die. Because of your sins. Your sins. Your consequences will bring. You don't understand that. Us living in disobedience to God bring consequences we don't want to live with. You think David wanted a child to die? When he looked upon her and said, oh, she looks so good. Go get her and bring her. Anyway, King Solomon, he's the son of she would have another child, his name would be Solomon. He would eventually grab the kingdom after David. And the Bible says that he was the wisest man ever. There will be none before him, none after him, as wise as he was. King Solomon, now, when God came to him in dreams, said, what can I give you for what you've done for me? All right, King Solomon says, I want wisdom to lead your people. I want wisdom to lead your people. So in the process of that, God said, well, I'm going to give you wisdom. And since you didn't ask me for rich, fame, power, I'm going to give you riches and fame too. Because you want my will, I'll give you more in abundance than what you wanted.
So people would come, Pharaoh, everybody would come to see Solomon. They'd come to see Solomon, to listen to him speak, to see his great wealth, to see his great beauty, just to be around him. And we read these things, and this is what you read on Solomon. Solomon was who God allowed to build his temple. You understand that after God, he built the temple, the priests were in the temple praying and stuff, and they were sitting and everything, and they were praising God and doing offerings and this and that. The cloud that God was in came down on the temple. It came down on the temple in a thick darkness that it went in and overwhelmed the temple, and nobody could be in the temple. It pushed everybody out. The priest and everybody was outside the temple praising on the temple because God came in and ran them out. Not because they did bad, but because his majesty, his holiness, he's God. Amen. And we'd be like, God, come down. But do we say, God, come down so much that we can't stay in here? We want to feel your presence like that, that your presence pushes us out. Are we at that point? All right, back on top. King Solomon, he's built the temple, he's done all these things, he's reigned, he's got the most wisdom ever. You know he pins most of the Proverbs, his downfall, women. Over 700 wives, over 300 concubines, he's sleeping around, he's laying around. Listen to me now, everybody says, well, this was biblical days, they did that. Okay, read your scriptures. Deuteronomy 7:3 says, do not make marriages with them. And in this context, I'm going to give context of this scripture. He was talking to the children of Israel, talking about making marriage with women or having your kids and your daughters and your sons marry with people outside of the tribe of Israel. He said, don't go to the foreign pagans. Do not marry them. Do not be with them. Don't let your sons and your daughters marry them. Why? Because they will bring in pagan worship. Deuteronomy 17:17, he said, he was speaking to kings. In Deuteronomy, he said, when you get to the land I give you, I will give you kings over you. He said, but one, he gave a list of demands that the king should not do. One of them was 17:17, he said, neither shall he multiply wives for himself, lest his heart turn away. What King Solomon do? That's 1,000. Think about being with 1,000 women. I can't deal with one. Some girls deal with 1,000. Like, no wonder you failed. But I'm telling you, Solomon, I could have taught you on that one. Shoot, you wise? You was that wise? Nah, you something wrong. Anyways, 1 Kings 11:3. It teaches you about the 700 and 300. And, the scripture goes on to tell you that these wives turned his heart away from God. Solomon would go to set up shrines on high places, places of pagan worship, so that his wives, who manipulated, would they could go. They'd say, let me build something for me to go worship so I don't have to travel all the way back home. And he did it. And he built it. And before long, not only was he built these for his wives, he started worshiping on them. And he started offering on them. And next thing you know, God comes to Solomon, not once, but twice. He don't say what was said. He just says that God says that he came to Solomon, and Solomon continued to do evil in the sight of the Lord. Deception. You don't think Satan's a smooth operator? He will find your weakness. He will find your weakness, and before you know it, he's cut you, and he's took you to a place you don't want to be. To a place that where even you won't turn back from him, because it tastes so sweet. And then when God warns you, you'll be like, this still tastes sweet. Now, do you understand that the next 3 to 4 kings after Solomon would all do evil in the sight of the Lord? his son would actually do worse than him. Anyways, I'm just telling you that. I know it was a long tangent away from Jude, but it was a lot to let you understand just how it don't matter where you are at. You can be a pastor, you can be a lay person, you can have a 15,000 member church, you can have a 5-member church in your house. It does not matter. You can be a CEO, you can claim to be a janitor. It doesn't matter if God, if Satan wants you, if you're not clinging into God for the power to defeat him, he will deceive you and he will get you. This brings us back to Jude of how does these people creep in? Well, first they're deceived by God and then they slide in. And then what is their objective? Verse 14. We're going to start in verse 14, Jude verse 14. Now Enoch, Old Testament guy, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men saying, listen to this, the seventh generation from Adam prophesied about who we're talking about today. So what was relevant then is relevant today. Prophesied about these men also saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints. To what? Execute judgment on all. He comes to execute judgment on all. Continuing. All who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds. He comes to execute judgment on all, but also the ungodly about their ungodly deeds. That's what he's coming back to do. It says he's coming with thousands of saints. But he says this here, furthermore, okay, of their ungodly deed, which they have committed in an ungodly way, do not sit in here and lie and say you don't see it. You don't see the things that are going on in the world. You don't think having abortions where we go in a woman's body and kill a baby is not an ungodly deed in an ungodly way? You don't think torturing little kids to the point to where they, you don't think it's ungodly? Have you ever had a kid? Would you dare let someone do it to you? Do you understand that Disney World to this day, well not now because they're not really open about it, but lost 700 kids a year? How you have security guards everywhere with parents with kids and you're losing 700 a year? Ungodly deeds in an ungodly way, and sometimes we can't wrap our minds around it, but it's happening. But one day God's coming to convict judgment. You understand? And of all the harsh things which the ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Do you understand that you don't have to defend God? It's nice if you do, but you don't have to argue with someone and defend him because someone says something bad about God. You understand he can defend himself? You understand in the Bible there was no battles won without his power? And the only battles Israel ever lost was because God gave them up because of their sin? He don't need you to defend him. He needs you to be obedient in what he's told you to do. He didn't tell you to go argue with somebody. He said, tell them the gospel. If they don't want to hear it, walk away. Leave in a good manner so that they see your good works. But if you tell them about the gospel and then fight with them, what do they see? Verse 16. These are grumblers. How many times have you seen people in the church grumble about everything? I don't lie to you. Some of them won't come out open about it. They'll be over there arguing with this group of people about it. Next thing, this whole group, I don't like to have music either. I didn't even know it. I'm glad you brought it up. I didn't know I didn't like that song. I thought I liked it, but now I don't. I'm glad you told me. You know what? I didn't like the way that preacher talked. I mean, he had me going for a little while. I even hit an amen. Now you're right. Next week, I'm going to come in monotone. I don't like this man. They come in drunk in the midst of you. Complainers. Walking according to their own lust. They don't care about what's going on in church. They don't care about God moving. They don't care about souls being saved. You had five come down to the altar, except Christ there in the back like this. I'm ready to go eat. I'm not excited about these souls not going to hell. Flattering people, and they mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. They speak in a smooth way to get what they want. I don't get political and stuff, especially not from the pulpit, but do you remember someone that was smooth talking that everybody was wooed over and prayed for, but he did nothing for the people? Leave that alone. Smooth talk doesn't mean a person's got your right intents or God's right intents for them. Just because they say what you want them to, and they say it's slick and good, you don't understand that say it makes everything look good. He's smooth about it. You won't surely die for eating that apple. It's going to taste good. God don't want you to eat it because it'll make you like him. He's smooth. Flattering words. Verse 17, but you beloved, listen, but you beloved, remember the word. You never say, in the Bible, a lot of times this happens. There'll be all this stuff you have to remember. Look at this. Oh, this is all bad. God, and he was flipping script. Remember this stuff. Remember. But remember, when you hear things like this, and I know Pastor Chip said it like this, if you see the word therefore, find out what it's there for. But remember means you need to remember. Listen. But you beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember what they preached. Remember the gospel. Remember what they were speaking on. How they told you that there would be mockers in the last time, or in the last days, there will be mockers of the gospel, mockers of Christ, mockers of God, mockers of the church, mockers of the things of God. Listen to me. And in the last time, okay, who would walk according to their own ungodly lust? These are sensual persons who cause division, not having the Spirit. People will come into church. They won't have the Spirit of God. They may even come down to an altar, but they will be here to cause division. If they cause division amongst the church, they are not of God. Listen to me, church. And I know they'll be like, well, I thought this person loved God, and we just had a little argument. No, but if they're causing division in the church, they are not of God. Now, don't get mad at someone because they don't like a thing and they move away from one church to another church, but they're still in love with God and y'all can still come together and y'all can pray, but I didn't think it was best fit for me. But if they stay in the church and try to divide the church, that's the issue. Verse 20, but you beloved, building yourselves up. Listen to me now. This is the application that we must apply. I did all of this for this small section of verses of how we can apply these things. Listen to what he teaches. But you, beloved, building yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. And he's saying, build each other up. He's talking to the church. He said, you must build each other up, praying for one another, encouraging one another, praying in the Holy Spirit. Understand? Letting the Spirit guide your prayers for one another. So when the Holy Spirit puts someone on your mind, you can be praying for them. Stop what you're doing and pray for them. If you're walking right down the street and they say, hey, and David just pops in your head, and you're like, I wonder what he's got going on. I don't know, but I'm going to pray for him right now. I'm going to pray because there's a reason why he popped in my head and I have no reason for it. God's working in something and he just wants me to pray for him. That's the Holy Spirit teaching you to pray in the Spirit, because you will pray for him not knowing what's the issue, and you will pray things that you don't understand, but God will move in it. Verse 21, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ until eternal life. Stay in the love of Christ and look for it. Stay. Look for the mercy of God. Stay in God's will. Do your best. Strive for it. Just because we can't be perfect don't mean we don't seek to be. God always said, be holy because I'm holy. Not, well, no, you can't be holy, so don't do it. He said, be holy, for I'm holy. The New Testament scriptures, who was speaking on this, prophets, he said, run from temptation. Don't fight it. Run from it. Run to the arms of God. Run to the cross. Run from it, because you can't fight it on your own. They teach these things that we so we can apply it. Run from it. Run to the cross. Run to the mercy of God. Run. Verse 22. And on some, and on some have compassion, making a distinction. We don't want to talk about this in church, because once they start doing the sins we don't like, we want to address it, and even to the point of pushing them out of church. But have compassion on them. Those that are struggling, we're supposed to have compassion on them. If their faith is wavering, we should lift them up. We should be praying for them. We're lifting them up, encouraging them, having compassion on their sin. Because you know what? We're what? All sinners. We've all fallen. I stand here probably being the worst of you. I know me. I know me. I went for a run last night because I couldn't wrap my head on what God was working on. And in the midst of it, I went 3 miles. In the midst of it, I was on my knees weeping like a baby. I couldn't even run. I couldn't focus. I'm over here crying like, why am I acting like this? What is going on? For real. And others, listen to me. Verse 23, if you don't hear nothing in what I've said, do not miss this. But others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating the garment defiled by the flesh. He says, save them, rescue them, pull them out of the fire. Paul said he would stand in the gates of hell to save one. You can't see in here not raise your hand and say you don't know a lost person. He said, man, save them. Have compassion and uplift the church, but go out and save them, pulling them out of the fire. But he ends like this, and we're going to finish. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present your faultlessness before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, and both now and forever. Amen. Now to him, verse 24, who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless. To him be the praise, glory. Listen to me, church. If you're not in here and you don't know him, I speak these things to the church that we need to be laying on the altar between heaven and hell for people. We need to, the world's getting rough. It's hard out there. You cannot look at the children that have been brainwashed running around in the street and not hurt for them. I wake up every morning thankful but also saddened that I brought four kids in this world for what they have to deal with. Who knows what it's going to be like in another 20 years? Do you not think it's going to get worse? The Bible says it will. God is. I promise you, I don't want to say this like no prophetic person, but I truly feel like God is lifting his hands on America, and America's going to get what it gets because we kill babies by the thousands and by the millions. We sleep. You think Sodom and Gomorrah got it because they were immoral in just their sexual affiliation. Think about the babies we are killing, and we say, and we sing songs like "God Bless America." You don't know the God that I read in the Bible with. You think God's going to bless it? He's not going to bless us for killing babies, for living in homosexuality, and parading it in the streets. He said, go save them, rescue them, tell them the truth, preach the gospel. That's our one thing, because Jesus is the only one who can what? Present us faultless. We'll leave church and we won't weep for the lost. We won't weep over our sin. The older we can wipe the dust off of. If you're in here, if you can hear my voice, there is only one that can present us faultless before God, and that is Jesus Christ. He is the only way to heaven, and I will preach this every time. Every time I ever get a chance to speak, it will be said that Jesus is the only way. But that is not our only job, is just to say, oh, I believe in Jesus. No, he said, go out. Jude wrote it like this: go rescue them, pulling them out of the fire. I'm in right there. But if you don't know Christ, if you don't know for certain that one day he's going to stand before you and he's going to present you faultless before God, then there's no better time than today. There's no better time. Don't wait till tomorrow. Like, I heard about it. I've been talking about planting a tree, and I heard this thing say, hey, there's no better time. He said the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The next best time is right now. There's no better time. 10 years ago was the best time. 20 years ago was the best time. The first time you heard the gospel was the best time. The next best time is right now.